government is creating a task force specifically focused on tackling the nation's opioid crisis. That and how the crisis is affecting America's workforce is our first subject today on CNN 10.
Our nation is facing the deadliest drug epidemic in our history.
U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions says the government's committed to reducing the amount of prescription opioids that are in the U.S., reducing the number of addictions, and reducing the number of overdose deaths that drugs can cause. The Trump administration says in 2016, an estimated 64,000 Americans died from drug overdoses, the highest number ever recorded, and that preliminary information suggests that 2017 was even worse. It says overdoses of opioids, which include prescription painkillers, heroin, and synthetic drugs, made up the vast majority of drug deaths. Critics have said that through this January, the Trump administration hadn't committed enough funding to make a noticeable difference in the opioid epidemic. The White House says its $6 billion increase for the fight against opioids, which President Donald Trump signed earlier this month, was the most the government had ever committed to the cause.
Taft Farms has been in the family for decades. Dan Tyczynski and his son Paul have seen every kind of economy, but this is new.
We have had ads running in the paper, ads running online, and I have a stack of applications of people that I wouldn't dream of hiring.
A shortage of workers.
Qualified people are few and far between. It's not that people can't run a cash register. It's not that people can't make a sandwich. You look at their job history and it's one after another, and you realize this isn't an employable person.
It seems as though all the employable workers are employed.
The job market is booming, but the percentage of Americans working or looking for work is near a 40-year low. Economist Alan Krueger noticed a link between the missing workers and opioid use.
If you look at the counties where more medication is being prescribed, we've seen a bigger drop in the labor force participation rate for both men and for women. An increase in the prescription rate can account for between 20% and 25% of the decline.
Contractor John O'Brien knows the signs.
I have a little list in my head of things I watch for. Person X is really, really good on certain days, and then on other days it looks like he's just completely lost. A guy who has a backpack and he's very protective of it and he brings it absolutely everywhere we go and it's always that big backpack, that's a really good red flag.
Have you ever hired somebody and then realized quickly, oh no, I have a substance abuse issue here that's not safe?
Unfortunately, all too many times. I've had to let people go in literally every aspect of the business, from out in the field to in the back, in the kitchen, in the store. We've also dealt with a lot of people that are going through the recovery process, and there are stages and there are relapses. And unfortunately, if there's even the slightest relapse, you can't take it. We've had to let some people go that you really root for and you want to make it and you can see the potential, but you also, as a business owner, you can't hold that person's hand through the process.
I have to look at it from this standpoint. Is this a person I would put on a $50,000 piece of equipment and turn loose in the field where they could wreak havoc?
This is a new part of the economic story. The opioid epidemic, a personal tragedy now holding back the labor market.
We have an epidemic that is killing over 30,000 people a year. That's going to have macroeconomic consequences. And we're pretty close to full employment now. If the U.S. is going to see faster growth, it's going to come about because we find workers somewhere. The best source, I think, are the workers who are out of the labor force trying to figure out ways to make it possible for them to regain their footing and return to the labor force.
That's what Dr. Jenny Michaels does for a living. She is the medical director at the Breen Center for Addiction Treatment.
We have a lot of ignorance about this disease. A person with addiction has a brain that's different than a person who does not have this disease. But we struggle with that. And we judge people. And we also love to punish them. We love to put them in jail rather than rehabilitating them.
For so many years, it's almost very American to define yourself by what you do.
Right now, they're being defined by their addiction. And addiction is one of the most stigmatizing diseases in the world.
Amy Borden was once one of those missing workers.
Being addicted is like a full-time job with overtime.
Yes, it's every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's the only thought in your mind. And it's a job that you can't get fired from. I would work a month and then quit or be fired because I didn't show up.
That checkered work history, a red flag for small business owners. At 47, Borden has been in recovery for nearly 11 years. She says the gaps in her resume made employers hesitant to hire her.
I filled out numerous applications and I didn't even get a call. So a lot of times there wasn't even the opportunity to say, this is what happened. This is why there's the gaps.
Amy is now, by all accounts, a success story. Treated at the Breen Center, she now works here, helping other people through recovery.
When you think of the hurdles to getting to where you are, and then to hear from employers who say, you know, I'm not ready to hire somebody in recovery.
I think the judgment and the stigma has to go away. It has to. You have to listen to the person and just be understanding that it's a disease. Without financial stability, most people will relapse because of the stress of how do I support my family. So we have to be given the opportunity.
It's not a death sentence. If someone has diabetes that's not treated, they're not going to do well. But if we treat that disease, the sky's the limits. You know, it's true for addiction also.
Treating the epidemic, imperative for families, communities, and business.
So you can really see how not being able to get workers can hold back how much you can grow and how much business you can do.
Absolutely, I could hire two guys, three guys today. And it makes expanding my business very difficult, not having the resources to get to everybody who's calling. With the business owners, they're just sick and tired of seeing the same old, hearing the same excuses, having the same problems that in the end really does come down to hurting the wallet.
10-second trivia. Which of these organizations was established in 1945? The League of Nations, the United Nations, the Red Cross, or the Council of Europe? It was the United Nations that was established in 1945, though U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt is credited with first using the term in 1942. According to the World Health Organization, which is part of the United Nations, more than 2 billion people around the world don't have clean drinking water in their homes. That's about 28% of the entire world's population. And one threat that can hide in water is lead. It's a toxic metal. The U.S. government says no amount of it is safe, but there are some people working on ways to help others avoid it.
My name is Gitanjali Rao. I'm 12 years old. I'm in 7th grade and I go to STEM school Highlands Ridge. So I developed a device to detect lead in water faster than current techniques out there today. It uses nanotube-based sensors in order to give you instantaneous results on your smartphone of safe, slightly contaminated, or critical of the lead status in your water. I was originally introduced to the Flint water crisis through a STEM lab, and it was just appalling to see the number of people who were affected by lead in water. And I'm partnered with Denver Water, and I am working on performing my tests and doing research there. So at this point, I am working on redesigning the device structure, refining my sensors, adding various tables and charts for more accurate values. I want to see this in the market so that it's in everyone's hands in the next year.
It's common for guests to fly in for a news interview, but, well, what I love about this is how the anchor reacts. Nichelle Medina just settles in and rolls with it. The bird, a scarlet ibis, wasn't exactly an intruder. It was there for an upcoming segment on the San Diego Zoo. It just couldn't wait for its live shot. Medina said it was a good thing she had a lot of hairspray and that as a working mom, it felt nice to get a little scalp massage. So next time someone says broadcasting for the birds, maybe the animal was thinking, ibis I could get more airtime. Maybe it was hoping to plant the seed for a career in birdcasting. Oftentimes on the air, you just gotta wing it, though you know that viewers could tweet about it later. I'm Carl Azuz, and we'll be beat tomorrow on CNN 10.